Hello class 5, welcome to your science class. In continuation to the previous chapter that we were learning, that was chapter number 6, air and water, let's start with part 2. Okay, so let's see what is going to be the learning checklist for today. Today we will be learning about composition of air, uses of air and properties of air. So let's start. Starting with the composition of air. So children, air is not just made up of any one kind of gas, but it is a mixture of various gases. It consists 78% of nitrogen, it has 21% of oxygen, and it has around 1% of other gases. Now, what are those other gases? That is 0.03% of carbon dioxide, 0.93% of another gas which is known as argon, and it has traces of neon, helium, methane, krypton, hydrogen and water vapor. Now, let's discuss about some of the important gases which is present in the air. Starting with nitrogen, that is the most abundant gas that is present in our atmosphere. If you remember, the amount of nitrogen in the air was 78%. It is a colorless and odorless gas, means it does not have any color or a characteristic smell of its own. Nitrogen is the building block of the proteins and the DNA that is present in all the living organisms. Plants require nitrogen for their growth, but the plants cannot breathe in nitrogen directly from the air. Instead, they absorb it from their roots from the soil in the form of ammonia and nitrate. Ammonia is the part of fertilizers that is used to feed the plants for their proper growth. And nitrates? Well, nitrates is available by the process called nitrogen fixation. Animals, including human beings, also need proteins that contains nitrogen in it. So the way our bodies normally get nitrogen is by eating plants or animals that eat plants. So plants absorb the nitrates in the soil. And when we eat plants, we get the nitrogen in a form that our bodies can use. And that is done by obtaining the nitrogen or the protein-rich foods. Now moving on to the second most abundant gas that is present in our atmosphere, that is oxygen. So the amount of oxygen that is present in our atmosphere is 21%. All living organisms, including human beings, plants, animals, fish, insects, etc., everyone breathe in oxygen to survive. So oxygen is required not just for burning food, but it is also required for burning any substance in the air. Without oxygen, it will not be possible for us to burn any substance. The oxygen that is used is constantly replenished or restored with the help of plants by the process of photosynthesis. In the process of photosynthesis, the plants take in the carbon dioxide and they produce oxygen. So in this manner, we never run out of oxygen in the air. Now, the third important gas that is present in our atmosphere, that is carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is one of the most important greenhouse gases that help in maintaining the temperature of the earth.
Greenhouse gases are those gases that can trap heat into our atmosphere. So, in a way, they are good gases, as without them, our planet would become too cold at night and life would not exist. But too much of carbon dioxide can cause global warming, which is a major problem of the 21st century. Air has 0.03% of carbon dioxide, but these days, because of pollution, the amount of carbon dioxide is increasing in the atmosphere, and that is very harmful for our planet Earth. So carbon dioxide comes in the atmosphere as it is released during the process of burning and respiration. Plants use carbon dioxide for preparation of food, so it is a very important gas when it comes to plants. So once plants make their own food, that food is consumed by animals for their energy and growth requirement. And the process by which plants make their own food is known as photosynthesis. As we have studied previously, that fire requires oxygen to continue burning. So, to control the fires or to extinguish it out, we need to cut off the supply of oxygen to the burning substances. This is the principle that is used in the fire extinguishers. So, carbon dioxide is commonly used in fire extinguishers because it does not support burning. It cuts off the supply of oxygen by forming a layer between the fuel and oxygen, and hence it stops the fire. Moving on to another constituent of air, that is water vapor. Water vapor is present in the atmosphere due to evaporation and transpiration. The evaporation from the water bodies is due to the rays that is coming from the sun. The sun rays heats up the water that is present in the water bodies such as oceans and rivers, and the water gets converted into water vapor and rises up in the atmosphere. And transpiration, if you remember, in the previous chapters we have already discussed that transpiration is the process in which the plants lose excess water in the form of water vapor. So because of these two processes, we have water vapor in our atmosphere. The amount of water vapor in the air is known as humidity. Water vapor helps in keeping the environment cool, and it is also a part of the water cycle. So, in this way, it helps the water that is lost in the form of evaporation by sending it back to the surface of the earth. So, the amount of water vapor or the humidity is not constant in all the places. So, it keeps on changing from one place to another. The coastal regions have a high amount of water vapor due to evaporation from the sea. And the plain regions have a high amount of water vapor in the air only during the rainy season. So where do you think will humidity be more? In a tropical rainforest or a boreal forest? Well, the answer to this question is tropical rainforest, because in tropical rainforest, we have constant rainfall. If we have constant rainfall and higher temperatures, so the water is going to be evaporated again into the air, leading to increased humidity.
Did you know that air is also responsible for causing rusting? Now, what is rusting? Rust is the reddish brown colored substance that gets deposited on the surface of the iron when it is exposed for a longer time. So what happens is that this iron, it comes in contact with the oxygen and moisture, that is the water vapor that is present in the air, and then it reacts to produce this reddish brown substance. This process is known as rusting.
Now, apart from the important components of the air, there are also some harmful substances that are present in the air everywhere. That is the dust and smoke. Now, from where does the dust and smoke come into the air? Dust is released from the various construction sites and smoke is released from burning garbages. It is also released from the chimneys of the factories and also it is given out by the vehicles. Now, what we need to know here is that cities produce more amount of dust and smoke because of increased amount of population in it. Because there are more number of people living in the cities, so they create more pollution. People can develop various allergies and diseases if they inhale a lot of dust and smoke. Allergies such as coughing and sneezing can be caused due to these kind of pollutants in the air, and diseases such as asthma, bronchitis and lung cancer can be caused due to dust and smoke. Let's discuss some uses of air quickly. We breathe in air. We are able to be alive because of the oxygen that is present in the air. Without oxygen, we will not be able to survive on this planet. Air provides a medium for planes, birds and insects to fly. Because of the air, the ships are able to sail. Air also provides a medium for sound to travel. Because of the air, we are able to listen to the sounds that is produced. If you are able to hear my voice, that is just because of the air that is present around us. Do you know that in the outer space, there is no air? Outside the earth, we have no air. As a result, no sound can be heard there. Then, fire also needs air for burning. None of the substances could be burned without air. There are more uses of air. For example, you are able to suck the cold drink from the straw because of the pressure of the air. You are able to clean your house with the help of a vacuum cleaner because of the air. So these are some of the important uses of the air. Now, coming on to the last topic of the day, that is the properties of air. The first property states that air has weight and it occupies space. So whenever you take a deflated balloon and you start blowing air into it, you see that the size of that balloon starts to increase. As much as you blow in air, that much will the size increase. The next property is that air exerts pressure. Air exerts pressure into the container on all of its side, in whichever container it is filled. For example, if you are riding your bicycle and all of a sudden you notice that the air in your tires is less, what will you do? You will pump in air into it. And when you pump air into that particular tires of the bicycle, then the entire tire gets inflated and the air gets distributed uniformly in the complete tire. That is because the air is exerting pressure on all the sides of the tire from the inside. So these are the two important properties of air. So that's all for today. In the next class, we will meet with some more interesting topics. Till then, thank you and have a nice day.